Wow, this has been a long time coming, but I'm very, very excited to stand on this special TED red dot and say welcome to TEDx Belfast. TEDx Belfast has been somewhat redundant for a few years, and we just thought it was really important that this is happening more regularly. So, first off, thanks for coming to a location that you'd probably never heard about before. As you've probably picked up, this is Town Square. Town Square is run by Peter and Nathan, who are giving themselves a hug there. Yeah. If you get a chance to speak to them later, please do speak to them. They're awesome guys. I guess there is a reason why we're here, and we're kind of, it's a logistical nightmare to get so many seats in here. It definitely wasn't designed for this. Town Square is called Town Square because these guys want to be the Town Square that Belfast doesn't have. They kind of want to create this place where creators and innovators and dreamers can come and gather and share ideas. So you'll see that through the events that they host, through the whole way down to even the menus are little notebooks that already have some quite creative doodles in them. They really are passionate about bringing people together and facilitating conversation. So we really, really thought that TEDx Belfast was a great way to launch it. And thank you guys for hosting us and sponsoring us, I guess, in all of your time and freebies and coffee and beer and everything. I hope you guys are enjoying your coffee and beer. It's all included in your ticket price, so go wild. Who knows how long that will go on for, but yeah, go wild until we run out. Normally people will say at this stage, can you please turn your phones off? All I'll say is please turn them on silent, but please don't turn them off. Take pictures, tweet. That's our Twitter, TEDxBelfast. That's our hashtag, TEDxBelfast. You probably only need one, really. Feel free to take pictures and Instagram. Another thing to say is this event is being live streamed. This is the website, so if you want to text your friends who couldn't make it, it's basically Belfast without the vowels, BLFST.com, and they'll be directed to a live stream page, so anyone can tune in from anywhere around the world, provided our broadband holds up. Please do just let people know that this is live streaming. We haven't made too much of a deal about it, but it's quite cool that Belfast is doing something like live streaming, I thought. So logistics, we're gonna have a series of talks. We've kind of split the night in two. There'll be a bunch of talks, and then we'll have a half-hour coffee break, which will probably also serve as a toilet break. If you're absolutely dying, the toilets are just back there at that white door. But if you can, try to hold off between speakers or hopefully to the coffee break. It's not going to be that long, I promise. Unless the speakers just ramble forever. I'm looking at you, Paul. So that's basically us. Am I forgetting anything, Becca? Say it again. Oh, this little remote, give it to Paul. So that's us. Thank you guys so much for coming. Tweet, Instagram, and I'll check in with you at halftime. Thanks.
I don't have slides. We have
Les, sorry, I forgot to introduce Paul. this is Dr. Paul Miller. Here we go.
Slides? Oh, I need this stuff.
You don't need it. So.
Got it. I want to invite you to close your eyes. Whatever comes up, comes up. There's no right or wrong. Mother. Maternal. Mum. Mummy. Matriarchal. Mom. Now open your eyes and come back into the room. For some people, that'll have been a happy thing, a happy emotion, pleasant. For some people, pain. Some people may have their mother still with them. Some may have a mother with them who's ill. Some may have lost their mother, as I have. Some may have been brought up by a woman who was not their biological mother, but who was that wonderful role of mother for them, as I have. But the thing is that words have meaning, and words have power, and they have feeling. And Mother talks about one of the most fundamental connections that we have. It's the first connection that we share. Tom Burns, a social and rehab psychiatrist, says, all mental illness has a common thread. It happens in the space between people. And so therefore, if we're going to have a role in helping people to heal, then we need to be in that space between people as well. Tonight, I'm going to tell you two stories about two mothers. One, a mythological story. I'm going to give you a brief part of that. And then second, I'm going to share the story of a real mother. The mythological story is important because myth, we tend to think of as the land of fairy tales and not really that important, but mythos is really rich. And in fact, I'm going to invite you to think that this ancient myth takes us back to a radical new approach to treating psychosis. We can think of neurosis as somebody gets knocked down by a car and then become afraid of cars, a phobia. That's an understandable thing. And Carl Jaspers, back in 1913, said that neuroses are psychologically understandable. But the other side of the coin is psychosis, and he said psychosis is only understandable as a biological brokenness. It doesn't really mean anything, it's just babble. And so that's followed psychosis right through, and actually, today the system still looks at treating psychosis as meaningless babble and just biological brokenness. The most severe form of psychosis we can think of is schizophrenia. And right at the start, when different people were describing what schizophrenia is, it started off with the really therapeutically negative intention, which basically said, well, if you get better, you must not have really had it in the first place. Not great, really, for a diagnosis. And I want to completely change that. So let me tell you the story of the handless maiden. We're going to join the handless maiden when, at this stage, she's had the real trauma of having her hands cut off by her father. She has fled into the forest and, as in all good stories, been found by a king who has fallen instantly in love with her. He needed to fix her, so he told her that he would give her and make her silver hands, which he gave her. And so she has these silver hands, and now she gives birth to a son, and she loves him. And whenever I was, whenever my wife was expecting our first kid, a GP colleague said to me, you'll never realize when your child is born that you could love something so much. And he said, you'll not be able to understand it at the minute, but when it happens, you'll know what I mean. And I've always remembered that, and you know, it was true. And I invite you who are here tonight to think maybe you are a parent. Maybe you have nephews and nieces, or maybe it's a partner or a loved one. But we form those bonds, and they're so important. And so for this handless maiden, she wanted to touch his skin, and she wanted to run her fingers through his hair. But with these silver hands, they look good, but she couldn't really do very much. And so she fled in anguish to the forest once again, taking the toddler with her. And in the story, she bursts into tears and cries so deeply that she cries a river of tears. And the toddler, wanting to come to comfort his mother, goes to her and falls headlong into the river, begins to drown. She screams for the servants to come, but there are no servants because she's fled to the forest by herself. And in desperation, she thrusts her useless silver hands into the river, and immediately they turn to flesh and blood, and she grasps the child and lifts him out of the river, saving him. And the key of this myth is to teach people that you've got to feel to heal. You've got to feel to heal. And that any feeling fully felt eventually brings us to joy. And so when we look at the story, I want you to keep in mind the handless maiden and the importance of feeling as I tell you about another mother. And her name, for the sake of argument, is Eva, not her real name. Eva was referred to me by our GP. And also, she holds the record for probably the longest GP referral letter I've received to date, 15 pages, okay, with rating scales. Somebody was practicing for their exams. But it was a great referral. But it basically said, please see Eva, she's depressed. She's had depression for 30 years. She doesn't really engage with the people that we've sent her to. And when she's put on medication, she doesn't really take it. And she has been to see a few therapists, but she never really goes for very long. And she's depressed again. Would you please see her? The psychotherapy that I use, it was developed by an American called Francine Shapiro, and it's called Eye Movement Desensitization and Reprocessing. Now, even Francine says it's a terrible name, but everybody knows it as EMDR therapy now, so it's too late to change. But the key thing about EMDR is it deals with what we call the Wizard of Oz fallacy, which is basically when Dorothy and her friends go to see the Wizard of Oz, initially she deals and talks to the big green face. It sends her off to get a broomstick, and she fights the flying monkeys, but it doesn't get her back home. And then it's only when the dog takes her behind the curtain and she sees the guy pulling the levers, it's only then that she begins to do her healing. And so in EMDR, we believe that it's information that gets derailed that forms this physiological, dysfunctional piece of information that we can now see in some scans. Work by people like Ruth Lanius in Canada, for example, has shown some really good scans. And that really helps to take away the guilt that a lot of people carry in terms of, you know, I'm too stupid. But really, a lot of these things that are coming up, it's a really complex interplay between maybe the genes that a person has, maybe the environment and what has happened, but also then what we call epigenetics, the effects of our environment on our normal genetics. So we don't have to have a brokenness in terms of our biology or our genetics. So with Eva, the first meeting, about an hour long, Francine talks about creating this golden bubble of therapy. This is the place between people. And so Eva told her story. And Eva told me a story that she had never told anybody else before. And this was a normal, functioning woman who had raised 6 children. But she had never told anybody before. And so sometimes I think we've got to look at a system that the system is still treating people according to a principle that was written down in 1913, over 100 years ago, that psychosis is unintelligible. What's the point in taking the detail? It doesn't mean anything. But it meant something to Eva. And Eva told me that she had 6 children, and she believed that 4 of her 6 children had been replaced by duplicates. She knew when each child had been replaced. One time, the child was taken away for its normal heel prick test after it had been born, and when the midwife came back, it looked like her child. It behaved like her child, but it didn't feel like her child. And worse, she felt that someone, person or persons unknown, had taken this child and were treating it cruelly. And if she wasn't a perfect mother, or at least a good enough mother to the replacement, well then, that would mean that her real child would suffer even more. And this was to happen 3 more times. And actually her depression was about coming to see me, being worried about that her last child, it was just an inevitability. She was waiting for this child to be replaced by a duplicate as well. Put yourself in her position. Seeing a child that looks like your child but isn't your child is a daily reminder that your child is being hurt, and if you're not good enough to this child, you can't feel anything for her. Your real child is going to be punished. Can you imagine what that was like? And yet she raised those children as her own. So within EMDR, within the trauma of these experiences that she had, and trauma can be as wide, and we know that, for example, bullying is one of the most troubling traumas that affects people. But in trauma, we want to try and move things on, to use the brain's normal processing. And in EMDR, we use eye movements or tapping or sounds to put in a bilateral alternating signal. And it goes into a part of the brain, and it works like this. If you and I wanted to have an intimate conversation and everybody else is really quiet at the minute, we probably wouldn't really feel like doing it at the minute because they're all listening, okay? And that's a bit like what happens to the brain. It stops that functional interconnectivity between the right and left sides and between the different layers. But if there was a lot, everybody was talking, so like before I started to speak, and if there was maybe music playing as well, well, it would facilitate our conversation in 2 ways. I'm deaf, so I have to really listen to what you're saying, so it improves my focus. And secondly, well, I'm not really worried what other people are thinking because they're not listening to us. And so that's what happens when we put these extra signals in. We can think of it as helpful randomness, and it boosts the signal that isn't enough, and then it allows this interconnectivity to happen. And it's the same sort of thing that happens during dreaming, which is mostly in rapid eye movement sleep, and Bob Stickgold has done research about that in the States. And so at the end of her second therapeutic session with me, treatment session, we were working on her not believing and not feeling that the children were hers. She had a half dose of an antidepressant. And so, or not an antidepressant, sorry, an anti-anxiety. So a very low dose of medication. And normally, a person with this type of psychosis, active psychosis for 30 years, we would be expecting to have, first of all, an antipsychotic medication, maybe high dose, and also you really wouldn't expect a good outcome. But at the end of our second session, she looked away, she looked back, and she looked away again as if checking something, she looked back, and she said words that I don't think I'll ever forget. They're mine. They're mine. I know that they're mine. And the most powerful thing about EMDR is it's not just a head knowledge. It's a heart knowledge. She really felt it, and she could own it, and it was to change her relationship with the children completely. And so I want to invite us that with a method like EMDR therapy, to move away from the negativity of the treatment of illnesses like psychosis, that they can be curable. Another patient who would have met the criteria for the genetic study I was involved in here, with the strictest definition of schizophrenia, is now 8 years medication and symptom-free. There's work in Japan by Akiko Kikuchi, which is showing same results. Daewoo Kim in Korea has shown the same results in new-onset schizophrenia and psychosis as well. So I want you to invite yourselves and the inter-subjective space that you're in to connect, to affirm, to empower, because people just might tell you things that they've never told anybody else. And if you're going to catch that, I want you to listen intently, to love fiercely, and to learn so that you can be refulgent, and you can look that up. Thank you very much.
Thanks so much, Paul. I'm not going to take any more time. Next up is Neil Morby, all the way from Bristol. So extra special round of applause for Neil.
This is so unprofessional. It's TEDx Belfast though, so.
Have we got noise? There we go. I can use a method if you like to try and crowd the room, a little dancing method. Okay. Good evening. My name is Neil Morby. I'm a mindfulness practitioner and an adrenaline junkie. And tonight I want to tell you the story of how I came from being a rock climber to a dancer and a mindfulness practitioner. So to start with, I want to tell you, rather than explaining how to live your life, I'd rather say, do whatever you want. This is kind of how I lived my life for pretty much the first half, and it was great. I had a really good time. But really, there's some key lessons that I want to share with you. This is me, aged 11. I was a very short kid with a big smile and a big heart. I used to love bringing people together. It was my favorite activity. I used to love making people happy and making people who didn't have friends have friends. As you can see, I was also a big adventurer. I loved judo and Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles. Yeah, life was pretty great. Now, one day, one summer, my mum took me to Portugal with my brother. I was about 12 years old, and I remember we went out bodyboarding. She let us go by ourselves. And I really wanted to show my brother no fear, adventure. So we went really far out from the shoreline. Now, there was this one moment. I was getting churned over by the waves, no control of my body. And I remember I made a decision to go with the flow and enjoy it. It was the only thing I could do, really. So we came back up, back onto the board, checked my brother was okay. He seemed fine. He could see the look in my eyes and the big grin on my face. Ooh. And I shouted to the waves, "Is that the best you can do?" It was this adventurous spirit that carried me through the summer. And then as I came into secondary school, I had a completely different shift. I started to face social dangers, bullying, overwhelm from subjects that I didn't enjoy. I found secondary school really hard, and I faced these dangers with a completely different attitude. I made myself small, I went under the radar, and really I was a completely different person. And so first of all, I started to interpret some of these truths as meaningful about me. I want to ask, why is it that sometimes I face social dangers with this kind of response, but I face physical dangers with a kind of adventure? I was focused on the adventure rather than on the dangers themselves. Now, I also have scoliosis, and this happened because of going to the gym too early. Basically, I started going to the gym at 14 years old. I was trying to build a lot of muscle into my body because I thought that would impress the girls and would scare off the boys. But of course, the result was I had to have major surgery at 17 years old. Now, that's not a great coping mechanism, and I ended up having a lot of pain from the recovery process. I remember as I was in the midst of that pain, I made a decision. I felt ashamed of the weakness in my body, and I felt it was time to be independent. It was time to spend the rest of my life having fun. So I took up rock climbing. Okay, so this is me. Someone's put a banana skin on the finishing holds of a climb in North Wales. Now, rock climbing brought me a lot of fun. It made me feel independent, powerful. It gave me strength. It gave me a kind of control over my own fate. Now, it's interesting that this is a coping mechanism. And in a way, we all have coping mechanisms. We've all dealt with stuff in life. And now we're doing whatever coping mechanisms are working for us. Some of us become shopaholics. Some of us become workaholics. Oh, thank you. And nothing's wrong with that. You know, nothing's wrong with being a workaholic. As long as it's providing you with what you need in life, it can be perfectly healthy and practical. But I want us to question our interpretations, our beliefs about ourselves, and why we're doing the things we're doing, and if there's fear there present. So for me, rock climbing became my coping strategy, and I loved it. I threw myself in head first with complete disregard for my own health. Now, in order to give you an idea of what it's like, I'm going to put you in the place of a rock climber. This is me on a climb in Pembrokeshire in Wales, but I'd like you to imagine this is you. Okay, so you're standing on a rock ledge, an inch wide, holding onto some very small holds. Your arms are starting to ache. You've got a heavy harness around you, and the rock above you steepens into an overhang. Beneath you, your climbing partner looks worried. You can see the rope dangling, swinging in the wind. Your foot starts to shake, and you start to imagine yourself falling, maybe all the way into the sea. And you think to yourself, Shit, I'm in trouble. Shit, what am I doing here? Now this feeling is actually what I live for and what I dreaded. This was the feeling of being alive. Adrenaline-fueled decisions had to be made. I could either choose to embrace the falling or to make positive action and start to climb. So at this moment, I would say, first of all, we take a breath. Long, deep breath. and we say, it's okay, I'm okay, I can do this. With that, we start to move. Positive action, and the body seems to know what to do. It has its natural sense of balance, and you become climbing in flow without any thought. Because you're being playful, you start to use different tactics, and you overcome the overhang. It's around about this point, you might say something profound, like, woo-hoo! As you reach the top, your excitement turns to relief. Take a big breath, take in the view, and take in your achievement, and have gratitude for life. And it was this feeling as well that I lived for. It was the moving from excitement to relief. For me, that was the feeling of being alive. Now, I took to climbing to some new extremes. Here's some deep water soloing shots, climbing without ropes above deep water. And then even just climbing without ropes full stop. I had 3 major climbing accidents in my early career. This one particularly was on the Outer Hebrides, where I pulled off a rock about the size of a surfboard, narrowly missing my belay partner, nearly killing us both. I was going into this with a sense of playfulness, but without much presence. I didn't really care about my life, and I didn't really care what impact my death might have on other people. Somewhere along the line, I had interpreted my life didn't matter. Fun was the only thing that mattered. So I want to question all of us. Are we doing things that's harmful to ourselves? Have our habits become harmful? And are we really thinking about the impact that we have on other people? So anyway, it's not all negative. I took a lot of positives from climbing. It gave me composure under pressure. It gave me abilities to use my breath and my words to control my state of mind. I also learned about trusting my body, and it took me to beautiful places around the world. This is Yosemite National Park. This is New Zealand. But in all of this, I was still chasing strength. Beneath it all was a fear that I was weak. I had shame about being weak, and I wasn't facing up to that. I was afraid to feel it. So around about my 30th year, I decided to move to Bristol. Climbing was starting to lose its luster. There was a hole it couldn't fill. And so I started looking at new areas of life. First of all, mindfulness and self-inquiry. Now, this is a big part of this is meditation. When I started meditating, basically, which is just sitting down and paying attention to the sensations in your body with full acceptance of what they are. Now, I found that incredibly hard. I would find that the pain in my shoulder blades from my scoliosis surgery and in my body from rock climbing had a lot of emotion, and I used to cry or I used to shake violently. But when I combined it with self-inquiry, which is a gentle questioning of your own beliefs, I started to realize there are positive perspectives in everything and that emotions are simply the language of the body. And if you listen to them carefully, you can understand the positive perspectives in everything. I also started to get involved in workshops in emotional literacy and communication in relationships. Now, these were group workshops, and they're happening now for adults. These are places where you can go, you can test boundaries, you can test communication, you can learn about things like consent, rejection, jealousy, and empathy. This opened a whole new world to me. Here was me climbing on my own, and now I got to be vulnerable and expose myself in groups, and it massively accelerated my learning about myself and about other people. I started to really understand my own desires and fears. But finally, the most fun one was self-expression. I've always wanted to dance. Now, I was very scared about this when I was little because dancing, I didn't really have much of a sense of rhythm, and you know, all the dancers seemed to get all the girls, so I wanted to dance for that reason, but also I wanted connection. I discovered something called blues dancing. Blues dancing is gender neutral, which means you can dance with boys or girls, and it's about connection and expression, not really so much about dance steps or lead-follow dynamic. It's an expressive dance, and it leaves space for both partners to add their contribution to the dance. Some people describe it as a conversation. Now, when I first started blues dancing, there was a lot of tension in my body. I was feeling like walking around holding my tension because maybe that made me more manly or something. But really, it was a deep shame. And people who danced with me could feel this, and it would be destructive to the connection. So I remember this one story from when I was dancing in Zurich. And this girl, she could feel the tension, but she kindly stopped me mid-dance. She took my hands, wrapped them around her body, and led me through three exquisite dances. She showed me the power of vulnerability and shameless self-expression. And I relaxed so much that evening, and I started to understand what dance was about. She also left space for me to express, which was really key. So I want to ask us, who amongst us is playing alone because we're afraid? Who of us are holding shame in our bodies? Are we afraid to be seen, to be really vulnerable? And can we start to question that with kindness? Now, just before I finish, there's a little thing about styles. As you start to play together with other people, I've noticed you require structures and styles. I mean, they're essential, really. They're kind of agreements between people so you can play the same game. Now, this happens not only in dance, but it happens in society with laws. It happens in relationships. It happens everywhere where there's people, where there's more than one. What I want is very important as we go forward is that we don't take the styles and the structures to be the important thing. That underneath there were reasons why we started dancing, why we started getting engaged in relationships. And it was these reasons of connectivity, of connection and fun and play and being present that are really important. And I think these could also be important in the classroom. I've found they accelerate my learning. So why can't they accelerate learning of children as well? As I found as a teenager, some of these messages about confidence, about self-esteem, would have been crucial for me. And I would like these to be present in current school day teaching. So I'm wondering whether these three subjects can become core in our teaching. Mindfulness, emotional literacy, and communication in relationships particularly. Mindfulness is already starting to happen in schools, and I'm part of that. But I particularly want to push these other subjects. Now, rock climbing, it was great, and I don't regret it for a second. But playing together, this is us in a dance in Slovenia. And I've discovered community. I've discovered that part of love is accepting that you do need other people, you need connection. And being vulnerable can feel as scary as any single climbing move, but it's so worth it. So what I want to leave you with is just this idea that it's okay to make mistakes, it's okay to be vulnerable, but come into whatever challenges you're doing, big or small, with what moves you, rather than what you should do, and with a sense of playfulness and presence. Thank you.
Thanks so much, Neil, and thanks for sticking up with the faulty mics. We're gonna try to use this one from now on. So we're two talks in, we've got two more to go before our coffee break. Is everybody okay? Yeah, we're good. Okay, next up is a great story. Give all your attention to Kathy Willis.
Thank you. Simple words, but ones that when they're spoken from a place of deep appreciation and gratitude, wield great power. Power to change a moment, a mood, and even a life. Thank you are some of the first words that we teach our children. Here you go. What do you say? Ta-ta. Good girl. We teach it to them because we know that it's an important part of life. It helps us to relate to one another. It helps us to feel accepted. To belong. It's part of our moral code and as old as time itself. It's at the heart and core of every major religion and faith there ever was. Buddhist monks spend hours practicing mindfulness of gratitude, and the Bible says, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will. Being thankful is also a universal theme adopted by nationalities, societies, and personalities. The singer Rod Stewart says, there's not one day goes by that I don't get up and give thanks to somebody. And you know the country singer, Willie Nelson? he said that when I started to count my blessings, when I started to count my blessings, my world turned around. So if having an attitude of gratitude is good for God, Rod, and Willie Nelson, surely it's worth our consideration. Thank you. Do you know most of the time that we don't even realise we even say the words? It's so automatic. It's only when we don't hear them that we actually begin to take note. For example, you go into your boss's office. You hand him that report that you've been working really, really hard on. He takes it from you, doesn't say a word. So you're kind of standing there, not really sure what to do next. And you think, is there something wrong? Am I late getting this in? Perhaps he's got something on his mind. Maybe he's pressures or something, you know. But hey, it doesn't take much to say thank you now, does it? Do you know, I don't think he's ever really appreciated how hard I work for him. I'll get. I never liked him anyway. Oh, wait, I know what it is. It's because I took that last muffin at the coffee break and I knew he wanted it. Darn it, there goes my chance of a promotion. Or you might take that report into your boss, hand it to him. He looks up at you with a smile and says, thank you so much, Kathy. And so long as that's your name, of course, you may well go out of the office thinking, do you know, I'm so glad I worked hard on that report. I really like him. He's a great boss. Thank you. Power to change a moment, a mood, and possibly even a relationship. Way, way back when I was a student, I had this fantastic summer job working in a day camp for kids with special needs. Each morning we'd get up really, really early and we'd go round the various homes to collect the kids. It was not a pleasant start to the day. 2 hours in the back of a really stuffy minibus, driving around windy country roads. Within no time at all, we all felt really ill. The crack was nil. Everybody sitting, heads down, subdued, sick bags to the ready. Towards the end of a run, we would collect a little guy called Johnny O'Neill, a 10-year-old boy who had Down syndrome. Johnny lived in a very small house with his mum, Mary, his 13 brothers and sisters, and his dad, who was terminally ill. When we got to their house, the back door of the minibus would be flung open, and there would be Mary standing. And it was her voice that hit you first, hugely bright and cheery. Good morning to you all, and how are you all doing in this fine and wonderful morning? Everybody in the bus would look up, and then it was her huge smile that got you next. And how are you all doing in this fine and wonderful day? Would you look at this blue sky? Isn't it absolutely gorgeous? Sure, you couldn't have asked for a nicer day. Or when it was pouring with rain, would you look at this rain? And sure, thank God for it. The farmers really need this. And sure, don't you have a lovely warm and dry place to spend the day? The door would close and we were off again. And it was all over in a couple of minutes. But in those minutes, it was like a breath of fresh air had just blown into that minibus. Everyone was smiling. The mood had radically lifted. And I, for one, suddenly felt really glad about the job that I was doing. And looking around at all those little faces in the minibus, just felt this surge of love for them that definitely had not been there 10 minutes earlier. You know, even after the 17th rendition of the wheels on the bus go round and round and round and round, the mood was still good. I don't know what Mary's life was like, but I'm sure it can't have been easy. She was just an ordinary woman, yet one so practiced in the art of thankfulness that it gave her an attitude of gratitude, that gave her a joie de vivre that was completely infectious. I know that we were all the better off for those early morning encounters with her. She had the power to change the moment and the mood on that bus. And you know, in the days that little Johnny couldn't come and we didn't see Mary, the world always felt that little bit darker. The writer Anne Voskamp said, "The brave who focus on all things good, beautiful and true, even in the small, who give thanks for it all, they are the change agents who bring fullest light to all of the world." When I started to look into what's been written on thankfulness, the list of benefits was really quite impressive. Improvement in health and general well-being, a sense of greater connectedness to the world around us, to nature and to other people, appreciation of what we have rather than always looking at what we don't have, greater freedom from the worries and stresses of life. It can help us become less negative, less judgmental, more accepting, more forgiving, more generous. And it can give us such a sense of peace and satisfaction that goes beyond what we do and what we achieve. Melody Beattie says, gratitude unlocks the fullness of life. It turns what we have into enough and more. It turns a house into a home, a meal into a feast, and a stranger into a friend. So on one hand, we know that an attitude of gratitude is a good thing to have, and yet on the other, we seem to be in conflict with ourselves, battling against strong forces such as ingratitude, cynicism, selfishness, fear, and the feeling of futility. These are my old glasses. They're chipped, twisted because I sat on them, broken, sellotaped together, and I can just about see through them. But because they're varifocals, you see they don't even work anymore. Because they're varifocals and they're twisted, I can't quite see through the part of the lens that I'm supposed to see. So when I'm looking at you all, it's all a little bit unfocused, and it actually makes me feel a bit nauseous. Not you personally or anything. And I don't know why it was, but I kept wearing these wee beasties for a very, very long time. I just couldn't throw them away. These are my new glasses. I finally got them the other day, and it was like an epiphany moment when I put them on. I suddenly saw everything with such clarity and detail. It was absolutely fantastic. They're so good that you think I'd never take them off, but I do. I leave them lying around. I forget where I put them. I try to get by without them. I even sat on them the other day. Fortunately, they weren't damaged. And even out of vanity, I don't put them on because I sort of think, maybe I should just look better without them. I don't know. But unless I choose to put these on again, my world remains slightly unfocused, unsatisfying, confusing sometimes. And I don't know about you, but if you can't see properly, sometimes your world can be a bit scary. In the same way, choosing to practice the art of thankfulness by putting on our glasses of gratitude as such can give us a better perspective on our lives. Now, you may be thinking, well, that's all very well, Kathy. You don't know my life, my circumstances, what I have to put up with, the difficulties I face. I don't have a lot to be thankful for right now. Well, 8 years ago, as a result of a horse riding accident and a number of very deep emotional issues that just happened to be in my life, I lost my voice. When I say lost, it wasn't like when you get a cold and you know your voice goes all hoarse and you lose it for a while and then it comes back. This was voice loss as a result of a very rare neurological illness called abductor spasmodic dysphonia, ABSD for short. And it ended up making my voice come out like this. And there was no cure for it, just a way of managing it that wasn't guaranteed to work. I was absolutely devastated because as a youth worker, community work relations trainer, drama tutor, putting on theatre productions with young people from across the city, I needed my voice. I ended up having to give up my job that I so dearly loved and had invested years in, and a lot of my dreams and ambitions went with it. I was also devastated because one of my greatest passions is singing. It has taken me across the world and has been a huge part of my life. I was told that I would never sing again. And I was absolutely gutted because after many, many years of waiting, my husband and I had finally adopted a little family of three young children. I could barely talk to them. I couldn't even read them a bedtime story. It got to the stage where I couldn't speak on the phone. I didn't want to go out anywhere where I might meet new people because their first impression was going to be of this bizarre sounding voice. My self-confidence and my self-worth took a massive beating. I became visionless, with no sense of purpose, unable to make sense of it all. At times, it was almost overwhelming. My life, as I knew it, had ended. Not a lot to be thankful for right there. Now I know that when you lose something or someone, that you need to grieve. And grieve I did, but in the middle of that, I also popped on those bad old glasses, the ones that warped my view and which I sadly wore for far too many months. On the surface, I kept going, but inside, I despaired. I was negative, angry, resentful, had little self-pity parties, bemoaning my fate, complaining, blaming others who I felt had caused the stresses which led to the condition. I cried, I ranted, I whinged. If only I could get my voice back, then my life would go back to the way it was. And I let those if onlys steal my zest for life, my joy, and it actually wasted a lot of my precious time as well. And you know what? It changed nothing. My voice was still as defunct as it ever was. It was like wading through treacle. Something had to change. The late Zig Ziglar said this: be grateful for what you have and stop complaining. It bores everybody else, does you no good, and doesn't solve any problems. See, I had to take those old glasses off, but they had become a kind of a way of life for me and were beginning to define me, and I needed help to do that. It took time and a few good counselling sessions, but finally I started to make a conscious choice to give thanks for everything that came my way. I gave thanks for the blue sky, a warm breeze, the beauty of nature, and even the rain, although on a night like tonight, that's very difficult sometimes. I gave thanks for my good voice days and for the support of some amazing people who were in my life. Thankful for my new little family who were becoming more of a blessing every day. Thankful for the little things that brought moments of pleasure and treasure. And like Willie Nelson, I found that counting my blessings began to change my life. A few years on, and I still have ABSD, it hasn't gone away. And although the treatment has improved my voice dramatically, as you can hear, there's not one day where I feel completely free of the difficulties it brings for breathing and speaking. Some days are much worse than others, but you never know when those are going to be. So to stand up here to do something like this is completely nerve-wracking. Because even as I stood up to begin this talk, I had no idea if my voice was going to come out or not. Yet incredibly, I am also an exception to the rule. I still sing, maybe not quite so well as I used to, but I probably sing more now than I ever did. But I was never able to go back to my old job, and I have grieved over that. Practicing the art of thankfulness has brought balance to my life. Now, I'm definitely no Buddhist monk. I still whinge, moan, and complain. My husband can testify to that. But I have found contentment and peace in living in the moment, giving thanks in all circumstances. And I am a more grateful person for it. Life is fickle. None of us know what we face in the future. And we don't have far to look to see that on one hand, the world we live in has become a place of great uncertainty, of fear, confusion, and disappointment. Yet our world is also a place of hope, of endless possibilities, mysteries, and adventures. It just depends on your perspective. So get on those glasses of gratitude, and you will find that thankfulness has the power to change the moment, the mood, and the life. Thank you.
Thank you very much, pulling very my tire.
Thank you very much, thank you very, thank you very much.
Thank you very much for the loan of your dryer.
Thank you very, very, very much.
Cadbury's Roses, their favourite scenters, all lavishly covered in delicious Cadbury's chocolate, make roses the sweetest way to say,
thank you very much, you're one in a million.
Thank you very much, thank you very, very, very much.
Thank you very much for feeding William.
Thank you very, 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 very.
Say it with Cadbury's Roses.
Thanks so much, Cathy. I hope all of Belfast heard that talk for the sake of this country. We have one more talk left, and then we're having about a half-hour coffee break, so hang in there. Next up is Geraldine O'Kane.
She doesn't like couches, especially leather ones. Siesta beyond your welcome and experience the loathsome peeling of exposed skin, akin to the slow rip of a band-aid to reveal an unhealed wound. And yet here she is, stretched full length, legs crossed at the ankles, when a hypnotic voice urges from a cavernous beard, "Take me back." Slowly from the compartment of her mind she pulls a memory, unfurls it like a ruby red rug, follows the path to the death of her childhood. It's 4 p.m. when she realizes you're late. The uniformed laughter of the bus stop turns caustic in her ears. Quietly, she slips from the group to the phone box sanctuary, lifts the receiver, connects to conjoined sobs, dials 3 little digits for an operator to inform her an ambulance is on its way. As she exits to the low groan of late afternoon traffic, the entire universe suddenly seems to be packed into her school satchel and pulls down on her shoulders. Realizing she is only a mile from her home, she begins to run but knows the battle is over before it's begun, as blue flashing wheels come in waves, then halt, envelop her. Looking round, she sees a paramedic motion for her to climb in. Like a field criminal, she is known to them. They arrive at her home to find it locked up, blinds down. Breaking in is like waking a sleeping child. Soft screams seep from the shattered window. Entombed in the ambulance, her mother reaches out to hands folded near her navel, as if searching for some umbilical defibrillator she can attach to her chest, restart her petrified heart. As tear-swollen lips slur, "I didn't want to die today," the daughter's inner child screams, "Neither did I," but outwardly smiles. "It's okay. Everything will be okay." But everything wasn't okay. For the next 20 years, Mum would be admitted to A&E several times in any given year. She would spend a few short spells in mental health units after overdosing on painkillers, sleeping tablets, and or alcohol. Many times I found her believing she was dead. That's a scary thing for a teenager and leaves a lasting impression on an adult. Things began to change in October 2014 when Mum lost her memory to delirium through alcohol withdrawal for 8 weeks. I've cared for my mum through the worst of her mental health troubles, and equally she has cared for me through mine. She once said, "If I wasn't ill, you wouldn't be a poet." She's always looking for the glory, that woman. I had to admit it seemed true, but I hoped that if Mum was well, the muse would have found me in a totally different way. I'm a poet and a mental health advocate, and this is a story of my mum and mine, my own personal journey through mental illness. Mum and Dad's first child, christened Mary, was a healthy full-term baby, stillborn because she was breech and couldn't be turned. Very ill after the birth, Mum was sedated, her baby girl was buried, and a photo was never taken. She never knew what her first child looked like. They were sent home with no counselling and told to get on with their lives. Dad got on with things by becoming a secret drinker until in 2010, liver cirrhosis outed him. I've never seen my dad drunk, and until then, I probably never saw him sober. People often said I was my mum's guardian angel, but if I was hers, then she was surely mine. When I was four, Mum took me to the doctors saying, she's not eating. The doctor told her to go home, not to worry. She'll eat when she's hungry. When you make yourself small, there are fewer details to pick over. At age 8, our hairdresser decided my waist-length hair was taking all my nutrients. So they cut it up much like it is today. But when you're 8, you don't really want hair like this. So they cut it up, but I didn't get any fatter. Caught in the epicenter of a divorce explosion, I was their shrapnel. At 14, Mum took me to the doctor again. I was prescribed antidepressants. We were playing hide-and-seek round our estate when he grabbed my wrist. Much older than all the other kids by far, he would know all the good places. So we ran. He took me to the best place. Scream, he said. No one will hear you. 2 weeks before my 18th birthday, I tried to take my own life. Mum took me out of my A-levels and my part-time job, saying, life is much more important. When I was 20, I collapsed in a shopping centre. That was the day Mum found out that I was anorexic. She took me home, she put me to bed, and she fed me on ice cream and jelly, soup and bread, chocolate, until I could eat healthily again. Sometimes when things in my life get out of control, I revert back to that technique and I eat things that go down easy. Recovering from anorexia is just that. You're always recovering. Easily I can slip back into not eating when life throws too much at me. And if someone doesn't make food for me, I rarely ever cook a meal for myself. I could count on one hand the amount of meals I've ever made just for me. And I'm 34 years old. It's all about having a healthy mind. When I was very sick, I couldn't see how gravely thin I was, around 6.5 stone at my worst. Sometimes now I feel fat. I'm 8 stone 10. And a little worry will glance across my chest. But then I look in the mirror, and because my mind is fed and healthy, I can see I'm not fat at all. Then it was my turn to really look after Mum. There wasn't any road I wouldn't go down to try and get her to help, get the help she needed. I've become adept at reading the signs. I would frequently find myself on the phone to psychiatrists and mental health charities on Christmas Eve, knowing she was about to overdose and trying in some way to stop it. Still, psychiatrists insisted, your mum's a wee bit lonely and depressed. When you're caring for someone who's only a wee bit lonely and depressed, there's not much support available. So my sister and I, we decided to support each other. It's easy for you to leave her. My mind is sifting for sense in your words. Wants to know how you could deal them out when I have been her prime care for over half my life. Instead, I admit, I've cried every day since I left. Yes, you say, but it's easy because you are far away. Static words crowd the line. You want to know if I'm still here. I ask about your impending weekend away, if you're looking forward to it. We don't often talk like this. Right now, I don't have much interest. We are two focal points blinded by our own search for the perfect lens. You, my ally, my support network of one. You who have scavenged with me through the devastation after her disordered personality has rioted through our lives again. You who has always helped me. Search for pieces of our mum and from the rubble, put together a stone mother, for even a makeshift relic will do. This year at the age of 70 years old, my mum finally got a diagnosis of impulsive but borderline personality disorder with depression. It turns out every time she tried to kill herself, She never wanted to die. She's now been given a care package, the care we have tried to find for her for years. But the road to this conclusion has not come easy. And I have had to learn to get help unless you push and keep pushing hard. Psychiatrists, doctors, social workers, accident and emergency staff, mental health teams, to take some action. When your mum has fallen down a full set of stairs, when she's been admitted to after overdosing twice in 1 week, when she's lost her memory and doctors are trying to make her go home, needing 24/7 care that you cannot provide for her. After Mum lost her memory for the first time, we were forced to sell her home. We had to rehome her beloved cat, Kate. She had to move to residential care and later on into fold housing, as she was told she was too young and too well to be in residential. Just after she moved into the fold, she took too many strokes, started to overdose again on painkillers and alcohol. When she lost her memory for the second time, she was admitted to a dementia ward. We thought we'd lost her for good. Finally, the breakthrough came when I decided I would be present at every doctor's meeting, that I would tell them what it was like for myself, my sister, and her children to see our mum so unwell and going downhill, and yet help always seemed to be just outside our grasp, because she was just a wee bit lonely and depressed. Supporting someone with mental illness is not always about trying to fix them. It's about helping them to live everyday life to the best of their ability and enjoying the good days. Christmas morning 2008. We were ragged with anticipation, having agreed not to open any gifts after midnight mass. We had wrapped the wee man's presents with dry food so he would open them by himself and not feel left out again. The whole family, on speaking terms, somehow had all managed a plethora of thoughtful gifts. As you and I sat unwrapping in our pink fluffy dressing gowns, the greatest gift was watching you. Your hair a blonde perfection, framing every ooh and ah and oh God, that's far too much. You embracing the day that was in it. Soon a deep wafting from the kitchen told us the turkey was almost done. With an apron tied round your waist and drying cloth over your shoulder, you relaxed into the first sitting, knowing later family would arrive for food platters followed by mince pies, pudding and brandy sauce, all made by you, head chef, head of our hearts. Someone came up to me recently after I read that and another couple of poems about mental health, and she told me that my advocacy through poetry and my openness on social media changed her life. She told me of her hospitalisation earlier in the year and that she had been a cutter from her teens. She wants to change career and work as a mental health nurse, and that because of my actions, she got the courage to go swimming again despite the scarring on her legs. If speaking out about mental health can change one person's life, I encourage everyone to speak up and out continuously. At the start of November, I was given an Artist Career Enhancement Award by the Arts Council of Northern Ireland. It allows me to take time to explore the impact of positive and negative language on mental health. Through a series of creative workshops looking to the service user and the professional health services, culminating in a first collection of poetry. I believe as a poet, and having been on the caring and cared for side of mental health, the onus is on me to talk openly about my experiences and to write about them in a way that helps others feel less isolated and that there is a positive way to live with mental illness. Suffering is a language of the past. I advocate for mental illness because I believe everything can change and life is always worth shouting about. Thank you.
Thanks so much, Geraldine. As part of the TED rules, the speakers aren't allowed to plug themselves, so I'm going to plug them. Geraldine is on Twitter advocating mental health stuff all the time. She also runs workshops. You can find her on Twitter. Paul Miller, who... Actually, I'll go backwards order. So Kathy Willis sings with BCGC, Belfast something gospel choir, Belfast Community Gospel Choir. They're absolutely awesome. They've just released O Holy Night video, and it gave me goosebumps. Look that up tonight. Neil Morby is often doing workshops around his kind of stuff, all around the country, really. So speak to him later if you want details. And Paul Miller has just released a book on what he spoke about tonight. So if you're interested in schizophrenia and that kind of stuff, speak to him and get his book. So we're going to take about a maybe 25-minute break. I don't know. 25-minute, half-hour break. Go to the toilet, get food, drink, whatever you want. I'll give you a shout when you have to get back in your chairs. Thanks. Okay, so we've got three speakers left. One's about to use this contraption. He'll tell you a little bit about it. A lot of people have been asking me who I am, and I realized I didn't introduce myself, so maybe it's a little bit late. But my name's Cameron Stewart. I'm a good friend of... Thank you. Good friend of Peter and Nathan's. I don't work here, or I don't work for TED or anything. I work in brand strategy, so when Peter bought the place, I kind of helped him with the vision of what this place is. And the reason I do TEDx is because I just care about Belfast. I think our stories are good, and often they're not told enough, and only the negative ones seem to make it around the world. So I was a bit fed up with that. And last year, I launched TEDx Cathedral Quarter, which went very well. That was established. A lot of you guys were there. It's good to see familiar faces. And then this year, because these guys were launching, and we thought, you know, TED kind of has the same vision as Town Square, we just thought, why not? Even though I vowed that I would never do it again. So I'm Cameron. Feel free to come and have a chat to me later if you want. We've got three speakers, and then who knows where the night will go. We'll probably hang around here for a while and then maybe head next door into the bar. But we can talk about that later. So without further ado, Paul Stapleton.
My name is Paul Stapleton, and I'm going to be improvising on the theme of translating improvisation for you this evening. Thank you. What does improvisation, what I was just doing now, have to do with child protection law in Northern Ireland? Strange question, so I'll say it one more time. What does improvisation, or how does improvisation relate to child protection law in Northern Ireland? As it turns out, I'm co-directing a project which is looking directly at this theme in collaboration with Canadian lawyer and legal scholar Sarah Ramshaw, who's leading the project. It's called Into the Key of Law, and it's an interdisciplinary collaboration with international musicians and local social and legal practitioners in family law. And so before I talk a bit more about that project, I first also want to ask, what do I mean by improvisation? So, maybe that answers a question, maybe it doesn't. What is improvisation? Improvisation is much more than making it up as you go along. It is much more than an individual's artistic expression. It is also much more than the sounds that I was making. Improvisation is about social relationships. In the case of what you just heard, it's about my relationship to this instrument, which is the bonsai sound sculpture, or boss for short. It's the boss. And it's also about my relationship to history, the history of improvising musicians, and my own experience as an improviser, improvising by myself, but also improvising with other people. It's also, importantly, about this very moment. It's about this space, the acoustics of this space, the unique sounds that you can produce in this space. It's about the context of TED. It's about those words behind you. Now is a good time. And it's actually about all of you as well. So it's a relationship that we're forming here. So improvisation is about, for me, all these sort of experiences, these past experiences, and how you apply those experiences to this individual moment. And so when people think about improvisation and law, usually you'd think that in law, improvisation is something you want to avoid. But actually, so law is mainly built on the idea of precedence. Previous cases help inform your decision-making in future cases. That's the general kind of common sense idea about law. But in reality, each case is unique. Each case has different parameters, different circumstances, and especially in child protection, previous cases don't necessarily tell you what the right decision is to do in an individual case in the future. And so in order for you to have a just decision, for a judge to make the correct decision, they have to improvise. They have to use that prior knowledge, but they have to be sensitive to the unique things that are unfolding in front of them. And so this is something we've learned in the project so far. So in both music and law, from talking to these musicians and legal practitioners, we've learned that improvisation importantly relates to a few key concepts. These are decision-making and discretion, intuition and anticipation, attentive listening and empathy, adaptability and responsibility. So these are all crucial within improvisation, both within legal frameworks and within music. The project, Into the Key of Law, is actually part of larger activities of a research group I'm involved with at Queen's University Belfast called Translating Improvisation. It's also the name of this talk. So the Translating Improvisation group is not just a collection of musicians and legal scholars. It also involves sociologists, anthropologists, architect students and architect professors and architect professional practitioners, modern language scholars, lots of different people, all brought together with a common question of how do we better understand the role that improvisation plays within our domains, within our disciplines. So I'm sort of championing this idea of improvisation as a positive thing, but also improvisation is dangerous. I should be really clear about that. Improvisation carries the possibility of failure and significant risks. And in child protection law particularly, these risks are huge. They have huge consequences. Could even be the difference between life and death. So this is all the more reason that we need to better understand improvisation to make it more transparent in the activities that we engage in. And it's also important to understand that actually no amount of bureaucracy, no amount of procedures, no amount of targets will ever replace the ability of skilled workers, skilled professionals, to be able to respond to the uniqueness of individual situations. Social workers going into situations where they have to decide whether they are taking a child away from the family, no amount of preparation will prepare them to make the right decision. They have to actually be able to respond in that moment to the uniqueness of each case. So for us, I'm pushing this idea that we need to trust again in our collective experience and move and thinking beyond bureaucracy to the knowledge that we have actually in our bodies and how this actually helps us make decisions. Because it is essential. Improvisation plays a central role in the creativity, community, and social justice in all of our society. Thank you very much.
Can we take this off?
Yeah.
Could you give us a hand taking this off?
It'll just be 1 second.
Okay, don't forget to tell all your friends that we're live streaming. I've had texts from San Francisco, Australia, and most importantly, Cardiff, my sister, hey Mo. Yeah, that's awesome. You know, San Francisco and Australia, that's crazy. BLFST.com is where you can watch this live. And hello to, I don't know what camera I look at. Hello to everybody who's tuning in. Next up, we have Gavin Miller.
Hello. Oh, hello. Thanks very much, first of all, to Nathan and Peter, Becca, Cameron, for the invite. Pardon my terrible mic technique. Maybe this is what I can take the advice from this talk, in fact. So we're going to talk about progress. Progress is intrinsic to success because success has much more to do with the direction you're heading in rather than the rung of the ladder you're on. I'm keen to avoid self-help buzzwords that might talk about how you can achieve success. I will assume that you have identified your passion, you're applying your talent, and you work hard every day to achieve your heart's desire. In this case, you're already a success. The principles I'm going to discuss are a result of personal necessity in respect of me achieving my own goals and much contemplation. So success is a big topic. For the purposes of the next 10 minutes, we will define it as continual and consistent progress in your chosen genre. Okay, so let's look at some successful people and how they engage with their achievement. A caveat before I begin, I'm a huge fan of all these examples and hold their work in the highest regard. First up, Jimmy Page. This guy distilled his influences and found his own voice. For me, the hardest task for any artist. He is the master of the sublimated guitar riff. The work of Led Zeppelin is diverse and brilliant. The DNA is found in heavy metal, hip hop, and even folk. Over the last 20 years, the majority of Page's output has been remastering and reissuing the Led Zeppelin back catalog. This poses the question, is it right that the artist should curate their own legacy? Nothing wrong with that in principle, but when curating your legacy inhibits making new work, that is not progress. Certainly Page is on a high rung of the ladder, but his gaze is backwards. Let's contrast Page with Plant, his bandmate in Led Zeppelin. After the triumphant O2 show in 2007, which I urge you to check out, by the way, it is really triumphant, Plant flatly refused to tour with the band, despite it being almost certainly commercially lucrative and a massive ego stroke. Instead, he goes off, he makes albums with Alison Krauss and T-Bone Walker, Raising Sand, and last year, Lullaby and the Ceaseless Roar. Massively out of his comfort zone, but artists and fans were rewarded for this move. Absolutely progress. But perhaps the finest example of what I'm talking about this evening is Steve Jobs. Fired from Apple when it was a $2 billion company, the board completely disregarded the man's vision and genius. Of this time, Jobs states that the heaviness of success was replaced with the lightness of being a beginner again. He embraces freedom, this ignites his creativity, and he goes on to form Next, a computer company, and Pixar, who you might have heard of. Okay, so fast forward, Apple is worth a fraction of what it was when Jobs left, and the Apple board have to buy Next. They tell us for software, but we all know it was for Steve. Today, it's the most valuable company on the planet, and if we consider cash and commercial and capital assets, the brand value, and the brand value, I apologize, would be the 28th most, like, sorry, a stumble has occurred. It would be the 28th, the 28th most valuable valuable country on the planet. But more importantly, even than that, this man played a key role in how we all engage with information. To underline how embracing freedom can ignite creativity, after this bit of Oasis, Noel Gallagher released a solo album that clearly demonstrates the work of a liberated man. Jobs, around the time of being fired from Apple, shows us that failure is nothing to fear. And in fact, the path of failure ends with success. There are many examples that we can look at, both on the Jimmy Page side and on the Steve Jobs side, but an honorable mention must go to the following. Keith Richards, who for fear of repeating himself, removed one of the strings from his guitar tune the remaining five to a G chord and tells us that to make good music, we need five strings, three notes, two hands, and one asshole. Ferguson, Alex Ferguson, lived by the diktat that we should never be afraid to dismantle a winning team. So where does that leave us? Dr. Steve Peters states in the book The Chimp Paradox that there is nothing less constructive than a self-appointed victim. Remember that. And we are all aware of the maxim of being a victim of our own success. Were Page and even Orson Welles, who gave a Citizen Kane at age 25 but never backed it up, were burdened by their success, Jobs, Ferguson, and someone like Michael Schumacher thrive in their continued dominance. So, how do we avoid achievement paralysis? Simple. If it ain't broke, key moment, first time. If it ain't broke, break it, motherfuckers. While it is important to celebrate victories, it is critical to dismantle tried and tested processes in order to progress, to understand why we succeeded, how we can succeed better, and in new ways. Resting on laurels and polishing the family silver achieves nothing. This is an abuse of one's talent and precisely how success suffocates. Thank you very much.